half time scores the same. Don't fret, it's just a game. You realize it's always there. The answers to your prayers. I heard that you were calling. I heard that you were calling. Calling over there. I heard that you were calling. I heard that you were falling. Falling over there. Over there. Over there. Over there. Stay home to work things out. Your finds only fear and doubt. A shadow cast your way. No time left to play. I heard that you were calling. I heard that you were calling. Calling now. You're calling, you know I heard you calling, calling over there, you know I heard you calling, you know I heard you falling, calling over, calling over, calling over there, yeah, over.
So, when I was a little kid, well, just like a teenager, one day I was with my buddies and we were down and decided to build ourselves a little raft and float down the creek in this little small town called Williams Lake up in northern BC. So we built our raft, we got on the raft tipped over, we fell in and we took a big gulp of water, and then I found when I got sick, I was actually near a sewage plant. So I got sick for about 8 months with a disease, and then but the good news was my mom said, "Son, can I get you an instrument?" Yes. So we're living in a small little apartment, and I said, "Mom, I want drums." And she said, "Not gonna happen, son." So I said, "Mom, how about an electric guitar?" And she said, "Not gonna happen, son." So we finally agreed on an acoustic, and I learned to play Satisfaction. 1 billion times, and then I realized, well, she couldn't get me an electric guitar. But one day I was sitting by my bed. I got a drum. Take that, Ma. Then I realized I had a snare here in various places. Hi-hats. Double kick drum. And I realized the guitar had a lot of different percussion sounds on it. So I figured that's all great, but I'm playing the guitar, so I should play guitar. So I figured, what if you added a bass to that? That was kind of fun, but still, if you need a whole song, like a real song, you have to have bass, drums, melody, and a rhythm. So when you slap it all together, you get something like this. General idea. So the other day I gotta say thanks, Ma, because I got this. Thank you.
the really cool things about hanging out at NAMM is all the artists that come around. Don Alder here was getting ready to play, and behind him up came Muriel Anderson, and you can just see all these great artists running around, looking at the different booths. Don, you've worked with Muriel, right?
I have, yeah. I've done a few shows with her, and we're both harp guitar players, and I've got to play a few All-Star Guitar Night a few times. So yeah, amazing leader, amazing player, and what a great ambassador for Eastern Guitar.
Yeah, she's amazing. She came in for a session in our offices a while back. And you also, last year, you played with Chris Hatfield, right?
I did, yeah. I got the call to play with Chris. He's Canadian, right?
Chris, by the way, is the astronaut who did the David Bowie song.
The commander of the space station, and I guess he did that. He took the little Larrabee guitar spinning in space and,
right.
and went viral. So what happened is they called me up to play harp guitar version of it.
Uh-huh.
And so we met in Kona. It was a great gig, one of those top paying gigs and holidays and everything. And it was, awesome time playing. But what was so funny, though, is that at the end of his presentation, like, we played together first, and then did a presentation. And behind him, throughout everything, was this huge animation inside the space station. And so very expensive to render all this. And at the end of it, what happens, all these kind of red lights and sirens started going. So he's standing on stage, not sure what's going on. And he turns around, and he's looking at the outside of the space station now. And so we're all kind of watching what's going on. And all of a sudden, the USS Enterprise enters screen.
Oh, wow.
And then you hear this. This is Captain Kirk requesting permission to come aboard the space station. And so to talk to Hatfield. So they came down, he interviewed, and it was a great time. They both signed my harp guitar. Captain William Shatner went, "Space Man should be in a Star Trek movie." And I got to the airport, there's Alex Cooper, so.
Oh, wow.
So he signed it too. So yeah, good gig. That one.
Great gig. And it seems like you're the right person to do that. I think you're into sci-fi, you like The Walking Dead.
Oh, absolutely.
And your new album apparently has an image that was inspired by that. Talk about that.
Yeah, well, I'll send you the cover so you can see it, but I figured if I was to be a acoustic guitar player at the apocalyptic times, I want to have a modern guitar with an armrest level and all, stand frets and all that sort of stuff. But to cut to the zombies, I'd have to have the ultimate weapon. So I have a blade coming off the headstock so I can chop in that direction. I've got a big chopping blade at the bottom I can swing in the other direction. In between, I have a variable chainsaw that will go back and forth. My nails, of course, would be like Wolverine metal nails to slash and trash. My strings would be like whips and nooses. And if all else failed, I'd have like a flamethrower here at the back. And so I went to this British artist, and after a few renderings, we finally got what we wanted. It looks pretty cool, so it's fun. It'll be a fun CD cover.
That'll be fun. Back down to earth where actual real guitars are made and manipulated. Talk a little bit about the guitars that you played on the three songs that you did for us today.
Yeah, well, I'm playing, I'm an artist, so one of the great things about being an artist with a company like that is you get support when you need it for traveling and stuff. And typically I've been pretty tough on guitars with the right hand techniques and all the banging. And so what's nice is that if I go to a company like a country like Germany or anywhere like the UK, I can call up Yamaha and they'll make sure I have a model there. So I've been with them for about 10 years, and I'm playing their A-series, which is actually a very low-cost guitar.
Right.
And it's got their modeling system. So I use that, but I also strongly use, like, I use Seymour Duncan pickups on everything. I have to get some balance of microphone and magnetic. And so this is basically my staple pickup. It's called the Seymour Duncan Mag-Mic. And on the front, there's a main volume, which gives you all your magnetic. So it warms up the guitar in conjunction with the saddle pickup. And then what I do is I bring in the microphone. This is what I need for percussion. So I'm not using it for acoustic sound. It's just when I want to start banging and smacking. So the combination of the tri-source gives you a really, really great sound on stage. And once again, like, this is probably about a $700 guitar. And it's worked on big stages all over the world.
So you've used Seymour Duncan equipment for your entire career?
Absolutely. Yeah, pretty much for my entire career. I mean, I first remember seen, when I first saw Tommy Emmanuel play, he had this incredible sound, right?
Right.
And I figured, okay, well, the way I was working on getting that sound back then was a very complex system. And it had, like, mics hanging inside the guitar. It was just very, very complicated. So when I saw that system, I was like, wow, how do you get that? So after a bit of hunting around, I found that guitar just had released a system called the Timberline or Waveform or something like that. And so basically I started with working with them, and they got acquired by Seymour Duncan. And then I got introduced to the Mag-Mic. So great system. So when I have like custom guitars, I usually use a guitar wavelength combo in the saddle pickup. It's also got a microphone. And then I'll use the Mag-Mic, and that gives me now four sources so I can get to a lot of different.
So now Seymour Duncan is working on a newer integrated system.
Aha. Well, I just recently got notified that I can be on their kind of advisory panel. And so because I've been playing in this genre, which is such a strong going genre, with players like Andy McKee, John Baum, all those guys, we're looking at them influencing all the younger generation. And this younger generation will have a hard time figuring out how to get all these sounds, because typically it's hard to find an integrated system that does all that. So as part of that advisory panel, I'll be kind of trying to push that agenda forward. And also, you have two or three guitars with multiple elements, you have to carry around 60 guys, so why can't we come up with a beautiful little product that is 60 guys in one? So we're looking at some very innovative things. Your mama Bear, the new response to that, and you can floor hardware. So lots of discussion, and I will definitely be a positive nuisance in the whole process.
That's awesome. Don, most guitar players who do the percussion stuff that you do and who are virtuosos like you, don't also sing and write their own songs. So you're kind of rare in that regard. It's kind of like it doesn't seem like the same muscle does the same thing. So tell me about that a little bit. You sing, you write songs, and you play this virtuoso.
I mean, I'm one of these weird kids that grew up pretty shy, so I don't even think of myself as a competent fingerstyle player because I have such an awkward technique. You have professional musicians and you have artists, and I think I don't have any really professional skills, but as an artist, you break all the rules and break all the rules,
right?
And then you have to sell yourself and your music, right? So different track. But I think that's more the route that I've gone down. Virtuoso, I'm just a stylist. Like if you took Jimi Hendrix and put him in a recording session for a cinema picture, and they threw a chart in front of him, he might fail. I don't know if you do that well, but so that's kind of the way I am. But as a kid that can create lots, I can definitely do that. So musically, I realized when I was out playing instrumentals, I didn't feel that confident and I could carry it. Turns out I could, but I started integrating singing. And I found that, the voice is an amazing thing. All the instruments that can touch a person's heart, it's the human voice. And the way I learned that lesson was two times. Once I was playing in a high-end, high-powered open mic circuit, it was to perform. This was like a bullet squad, and they brought it to perform. So I got up there, I did three instrumentals, and I had one of my better nights, right? And I got off the stage, and the guy followed me to sing a song. And not that it's just a competition in that kind of environment, but he got up and feeling, well, how am I going to follow that, right? And he sort of looked at the crowd, it was kind of like an awkward moment, and he took the guitar, swung it on his back, brought off the stage, walked down the aisle, sang that chorus of Irish Lullaby. I didn't exist at that point. And that happened to me a couple times around the year, and I figured, so if I can harness that, it would
be self-aware enough to know that and incorporate that. That's pretty amazing.
But yeah, sorry, but the finger stuff, why don't I have never felt confident is that my technique is, I don't do the whole progression, I just try to build the and then my touch is a bit rough because I want to, that's my design, because I think I want loud rock voices.
Right.
Which means more about throwing power out to the audience and trying to connect there versus being totally accurate. So what happened is I used to play a lot of Wiltshire basketball. And when I pushed on the Wiltshire wheel, the camber wheels, I crossed my thumb in my pocket. So to the point where it was very dangerous, kind of very stiff and sore. So all of a sudden I just started swinging the wrist. And as I was coming down on the notes, I realized I could actually kick the wrist. So now I can do a morph sound, right? And then I realized I could actually go back and forth with the nail. So I got kind of a swinging, strumming, fingerpicking style. So that's kind of right, kind of more wrong.
It's one that is just all your own.
Yeah, so that might be a good or bad.
Don, it's so good to have you.
Thank you very much.
Thanks,
man.
Thanks, appreciate it.
Thanks.